Good morning, welcome to Discover Your Destiny. And I believe today is going to be a very special day in your life. The word that God has given me is specially designed for you. Oh, you might ask, for me? Yes, for you. God knows what you're going through. God knows what you've been through this week. I do believe the word today will speak to you. Get ready for a blessing.
I too am so glad that you joined us. Bishop Johnson and I have been ministering at Destiny for 29 years. We've been married for 49, and it has been our privilege to help people discover their destiny. God has a dream for every single human being, and we want to help you discover your divine call. The plan, the purpose that God has for you is the thing that will help you to feel most fulfilled. Listen to the word, and I guarantee you, the word of God will change your circumstance. Your life will be the better after hearing the word of God.
My subject today is concerning friendship. Somebody say friendship. And I believe our motto is that we're more than a church. We are a family. And in today's environment, I think we need friends more than ever. We need someone that we can trust that really cares about us, really cares for us. And so we're going to talk about some relationship concerns and the way our church is set up and asking God's blessing on the message today. Somebody said, let's be friends. And I'm grateful. I've heard that if you can find three or five friends in a lifetime, somebody said five. Now, you may have more than that, and you may say, well, Bishop, I've got 10 friends. Well, thank you. Give me five of them, all right? And then we'll be even. So if we can find five, I'm talking, somebody say real friends. I'm so sick of folk that say they're your friend, and then when you really need them, you can't find them. Amen. They even change email addresses. They don't want to talk to you. And it bothers me. I want a friend that if I'm in trouble, I can talk to you. I don't want anything from you. Sometimes they feel like if you call them, you're going to be asking them for something. So in the book of Ecclesiastes, we're going to read, and I'm going to put my glasses on because I have found out in the last week I need them. Amen. When I can't find stuff and it's right in front of me, I know I need my glasses. So I bought these glasses today, and don't I look more intelligent? All right, Ecclesiastes. I'm glad we're in a church where we can laugh and not be so stiff. Fourth chapter, ninth verse. It says, two are better than one because they have a good reward for their labor. For if they fail, the one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him that is alone when he falleth, for he hath not another to help him up. Verse 12 says, and if one prevail against him, two shall withstand him. And a threefold cord is not quickly broken. Somebody say a threefold cord. Oh, say it like you better. Threefold cord is not easily broken. Can you say with me, we are better together? Now, one more movement. My lesson today is let's be friends. Everybody stand at this time. Somebody said, my goodness. No, stand. Everybody, you're going to get a hot dog, a hamburger, free drinks. We got potato salad, beans. We got green beans. So you're working it off right now. As we play this song about friends, I need you to go to four people, shake their hands, and say, let's be friends. Are you ready? Go.
Before we go any further, let's be friends.
It's a word we use every day. Most of the time we use it in the wrong way. Now you can look the word up again and again, but the dictionary doesn't know the meaning of friends. And if you ask me, you know I couldn't be much help, because a friend's somebody you judge for yourself. Some are okay and they treat you real cool, and some mistake your kindness for being a fool. We like to be with some because they're funny. Others come around when they need some money. Some you grew up with around the way, and you're still real close to this very day. Homeboys through the summer, winter, spring and fall, and then there's some we wish we never knew at all. And this list goes on again and again, but these are the people that we call friends.
All right. Wave your hand in the air and wave it like you just don't care. Wave your hand in the air and wave it like you just don't care. All right, friends. All right, Karen.
When we first went out together, we barely knew each other. We had no intentions on becoming.
All right, that was the last movement exercise. And some of y'all started sharing recipes. I don't know why. You may be seated. Our text has just stated that two are better than one. Now, somebody may disagree with that, but I believe that all scripture is given by the inspiration of God. And if it says two are better than one, I believe there's a reason for it. In fact, it goes on to say, if two of you shall touch and agree concerning anything that you asked of God, we will get into that in a minute, he'll cause it to bring it to pass. So it doesn't surprise me that Psalms 133 says how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. So there's four levels of a relationship that occurs in the church, and we can say the body of Christ, but I think the word church is clear. These four levels of relationship, and you can repeat them after me, is one is fellowship, relationship, partnership, and friendship. Let's start out with fellowship. Now, everyone in this building, all members of the body of Christ, should be able to enjoy fellowship. We shouldn't let anything in the news, on CNN, that we hear in our job, separate us from fellowship, being that we are members of the same body. Fellowship just should be automatic. I'm glad. Have you ever been somewhere and you see somebody you know in the store, and either you duck them or you say, hello, hi. You know, because you know them. They're part of your gathering. And this church is non-denominational. God instructed me to do that. He said, because I'm going to be bringing people from all walks of life into this church. And I don't want walls. My background is Pentecostal, apostolic. What, if you all know anything about Pentecostals, they're pretty demonstrative, and, you know, and some of them, and then different parts of the country, different. But the Lord said, look here, I want my people to be able to come together and have fellowship. Nationality shouldn't separate us. Status, whether you drive a Bentley or Volkswagen, shouldn't separate us. Anybody driving a Bentley, talk to me in the office afterward. Your color should not separate us. Come on, somebody. And we got to be careful as a country. Don't let it separate us. So the barriers that society brings about when it comes to Christian fellowship should not separate us. We should be able to go to Russia or Cuba, New York. I'm from New Jersey, to Spain, Washington, D.C. I just, as I stated, First Lady and I and the family just came back from Cancun, Mexico, and it was beautiful. I mean, I was having such a good time, I almost felt guilty. I said, boy, am I supposed to have this good a time? You know, but I didn't fly back right away. I had the whole week off, okay. So I've been to Africa. I've been to South Africa and Cape Town and various places. And sometimes there is ethnic differences. We have to admit that. And there's sometimes language differences. I have to be careful when I was in Mexico, because if you say one word, they start talking to you. And then when you give them that look, it's like, what's the matter with you? You know. So I try to avoid, I just said I have enough Spanish knowledge. I had it in New Jersey in school, found out down here in Texas it doesn't work. Amen. The New Jersey Spanish just doesn't work. And when I got here as an installer working, and I was on the street looking for a street, I called my dispatcher, and I said, I can't find a street. I'm on a street, and it's called Mojave. They said, what, Richard? I said, I'm called Mojave. And they said, no, that's Mojave. I'm from New Jersey. What do you expect? So there ought to be a bond, somebody say a bond, of love placed by the Holy Spirit that identifies every member of the body of Christ. Doesn't matter what side of town you live on, what kind of car you drive, there's a power in agreement. By this shall all men know that we are his disciples. We have to have love one toward another. In St. Matthew 18:19, I mentioned it earlier, it says, if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. Verse 20 says, for where two or three are gathered, you all know what it says, together in my name. Now, you just can't gather in any name, but in my name, says the word of God, there am I in the midst of them. So it's a blessing for us to be in agreement. And my prayer is that we always remember that this church is more than a church. We're a family. And I don't want anybody or anything separating the family. So that's talking about fellowship. Let's talk about relationship a little bit. We won't spend much time on any of them. My time is moving swiftly. And my stomach is feeling a hot dog coming on. And so I'm going to hurry. Amen. Yeah, I got to be truthful. Amen. Relationship. Now, relationship is developed when people work together. And in the years that I've been pastoring this church, almost 30, I've seen people come in and begin to work together of all levels. We've had lieutenant colonels and colonels come in and just work. Lieutenant colonels work in the kitchen area or in the hospitality area. And serve without saying, do you know who I am? See what I'm saying? It's a spirit of what we call relationship. In the choir, there's all sorts of professions. And in the usher board, you would be surprised who's ushering you to your seat. And our greeters. And then we have family gatherings like D-Harmony that's supporting marriages. And the men's ministry and women's ministry that normally meet on the first Monday of each month. And then we have D-Kids. Destiny Kids had an awesome vacation Bible school the last week. And it was just beautiful, 61 children the first day, and it kept building. So these kind of items, these working together, responsibility of activity, should draw you closer together. You can't work with me as a greeter or an usher or in any auxiliary without somehow us getting a rapport and being drawn. So I thank God for a relationship. Let's talk about partnership, if I may. Partnership is a little closer relationship because it's when fellow workers with the same vision, same values, and heart and spirit work together, and they're working together because they have a common commitment. What is the common commitment between partners? Is that dream, the dream of the church, the dream of the bishop, the dream of the ministry is brought to pass. You know, if you don't mind who gets the credit, we can accomplish a lot of things. Anytime we start bickering about who gets the credit, it breaks up the unity. So we thank God for partnership. We thank God for those that are partnering with us, even in our endeavors to grow and be the church that God is calling for. We see some partners like Paul and Timothy and Paul and Barnabas and Paul and Silas and Priscilla and Aquila. Paul had a lot of partners, all right? And it's something about partnering with a person. you can normally count on that person to help you to your goal. Someone say, praise the Lord. And there's five kinds of relationship that's necessary for you to complete your assignment on earth. Somebody say five. And you repeat them after me. First is a mentor. Somebody say a mentor. Now, the mentor will change you. They'll try to take you to the next level, try to help you in your profession or whatever your dream is. And the second is protege. Somebody say protege. And the protege will challenge you. You're trying to go somewhere, be better, and the protege will just challenge you to keep on keeping on and not give up. And then there's friends. Somebody say friends. Friends, we're going to talk about in a minute, ought to comfort you. You know, if you got a person that's always, when you're in their presence, you walk away feeling badly, something's wrong with that. You ought to walk away from some people feeling better. If a person, whenever they're in your presence, you want to hurt them. No. If they're in your presence and you want them out of your presence, that normally is not a friend, okay? And I want to talk about being friends today. My best friend sits over there. That's my wife, First Lady Adele. She's my best friend. And I'm big and tough and try to act like I don't really need a lot of things. But when First Lady goes out and stays too long, it bothers me. You know how when you come home and you got one of them dogs, and when you walk in the door, they start. They don't say nothing. They just start wagging that tail. And that lets the owner know that they're glad to see him. And so for 49 years, I've been wagging my tail. Now, y'all don't like that. Is that too strong? 49 years, almost 50, and she just does that to me when she... When she enters the house, the whole house starts to glow. And ain't no sunshine when she's gone. Okay. The next category is enemies. And believe it or not, your enemies are really doing something for you. I must hurry. If it's no more than stirring you up, so that makes me angry, that makes me mad, I'm going to do just what they say I can't do. Your enemy can have that effect on you. Then there's something called a golden connection. Somebody say a golden connection. And it's someone who will link you, connect you to your desired change, your goal. One whom God will use to unleash waves of uncommon favor. And I do believe that God will assign someone to link you to your dream. Somebody said, to my dream. You may say, well, I can do it myself. No, there's always somebody that God assigns to you. Jonathan was the link to David becoming king. Elijah was the link to Elisha taking over the mantle and the power. And then Moses was the link, the golden link to Joshua. So it is possible that you could be a golden link to someone, or someone else is a golden link for you to get to your next level. Can somebody say praise the Lord? Now you must know everybody is not assigned to you. Amen. If everybody, this is a secret, don't tell nobody. Everybody doesn't even like you. Now don't feel bad, because you know, the Bible says you got to beware when everybody speaks well of you. Somebody's not going to like you, but you got to have enough confidence in yourself and in God that it really doesn't matter. I think too many of us are living our lives trying to please folk that we don't even like. All right. So I'm just saying, if they don't like you, God bless them. Love them. Pray for them. If they're hungry, give them a sandwich. All right. Let's talk about friends. Somebody say friends. Now, I need you all to help me with this, because this is it. I'm going to be short as possible. Be careful when a preacher said he's going to be short. But I am. If what I'm going to say about a friend you agree with, just say something. Just say amen. Somebody say amen. That's good. That was even in harmony. All right? Friends are people who share a common love and appreciation for each other. All right. So I'm talking about, I ain't talking about these phony friends. I'm talking about a real friend will have a common love and appreciation for each other. Again, friends choose to be with each other. Friends choose to socialize. See, some of y'all, the amens are dropping off. In other words, let's go to Denny's. Let's go to Applebee's. Let's go to, where's that pancake place? IHOP and Super, that other big meal they used to give you with the bacon and all that and pancakes. Where was that place? What is it? It's a Denny's. All right. See, somebody been there. Denny's. They have a slam or something. See, y'all been there too. Now, so friends like to socialize. Now, you be careful now. You have to judge something, because if you have a friend that they love to socialize, when you say, let's go to Denny's, let's go to Applebee's, they love it, but when they get down to the check, they can't ever seem to find their wallet. They can't. They've eaten. The lady has, or the gentleman has brought the check, and they still patting. And you keep buying the meal, and then they find, oh, there's my check, my checkbook, or here's my wallet. So I'm just saying, what you need to do there is have them put the wallet on the table before you get served. So let's put our wallets on the table, because you can't seem to find yours. And I've bought 5 meals, and you're still looking for your wallet. And somehow your arms get short and you just can't seem to reach. Y'all know that little commercial. So, but really, friends like to socialize. They don't even mind working together. I like this portion about friends, and we're hurrying. If you have a real friend, you ought to feel safe around them. Is that correct? Somebody shout safe.
Safe.
You shouldn't have to measure every word. If you're around a friend, so you can say some things around a friend that you can't say around everybody. So when you got to measure your words and be like walking on eggshells, that's not a friend, you know. That's an associate, but it's not a friend. A friend, now I'm not saying, you know, you get too common, you know, but with a friend, you ought to be able to go to a friend's house and kick your shoes off, even if your feet need help. And the friend ought to tell you, put your shoes back on. There's something. Something's messing the atmosphere up in the room. Okay. So let me just say amen. Here we go. I'm going to move down fastly. A true assigned friend will proudly identify with you in public. That good? So in other words, if they're really a friend and they see you in public, they're not going to try to look the other way, or when they're with a certain other group, then they don't know you. I got a story to tell about that, but I don't have time, okay? A true friend will adjust their plans to accommodate you during a time of need. Is that a good friend? In other words, we had planned to go to the movies, we had planned to do this, but your mom is sick? Well, my goodness, let's put that off on another date. That's a true friend. Oh, I was so looking forward to that movie. And you got to go check on your mom? Oh, my God. No, that ain't a true friend. A true friend defends you in your absence. Is that good? I'm not talking about a phony friend. I'm talking about a true friend. Even when you're not there, well, will not let somebody talk about you. Thank you. I don't let anybody talk about First Lady. Nobody's perfect. But I know her well enough to know certain things are not her. And a true friend, a person shouldn't be comfortable talking about a true friend of yours. Someone you love, you got to be, wait now. Don't talk about my mama. There's been a whole lot of arguments because somebody's mama was mentioned. So when it comes to your church, your pastor, don't let anybody talk about me. I said, don't let nobody talk about me. That was better. I felt better after that. You know, you just can't do it. That's my friend. That's my pastor. Don't talk about it. Now, prayer, never be guilty of anything they may say. But as far as you know, don't let them. Okay. Now, this one you might have to think about. A true friend will become an enemy to whomever you're an enemy of. You think that's good? So if I have a person that's been treating me badly and they become my enemy and that same person becomes your best friend, a little something wrong with that. So I'm not saying it's a science, but you know, you ought to have a little concern about my feelings. Okay, really fast. A true friend never uses information you've given them to hurt you. Okay. I'm getting a lot of amens from this left side. I must have some true friends. All right. A true friend will not break your confidences. Now, the best secrets are those that you don't tell nobody. Because you might say, you know, this is, I only told my best friend, but that best friend may have another best friend, and your secret kind of gets out. But God will never tell anybody. A true friend never covenants with anyone plotting your destruction. All right. Now, there's something called a frenemy. It's not in the dictionary, but it's a person that wants to act like a friend. In fact, we call it a wolf in sheep's clothing. And I'm almost through. Now, woe, the Bible says, when all men speak well of you, but you got to be careful when a person calls himself your friend and they are truly not. First thing I want you to know about an enemy, and we don't want to concentrate on this, but you'll always have one. If you're going to go through life, there's someone who's not going to be on your side as you would have them. And you don't let that bother you, you know. In fact, the more you like yourself, the less you care about whoever doesn't like you, okay. An enemy is one who attempts to sabotage the assignment God has for you in life. Any time somebody wants to sabotage your blessings, that's not a friend. An enemy is unhappy over your increase or progress. A woman that's an enemy gets mad when you walk down the aisle. When you get married, say you're getting having a wedding, she's just as angry. I hope she trips over her gown. If you can't be happy for my blessing, then you're not going to get one. An enemy would rather discuss your past than your future. An enemy is sometimes somebody close to you. Somebody over here has got one of those. David said in the word of God, as I conclude, the reason why it got me so upset is that the person that did me wrong was not an enemy. Neither were they ones that hated me, but the person that did me wrong was my equal. Doesn't it hurt when you're equal, somebody in the church, somebody you worship with does you wrong, and you walk upon them talking about you? Doesn't that hurt? He said, the person that hurt me so badly was my guide, my acquaintance. We ate sweet bread together. And so my desire is for us to put our hands together for how many of y'all have at least three great friends? Let me see your hands. You're blessed. How many of y'all have five? You can think of five? Oh, getting thin. How many of y'all in here thinks nobody likes you? I want to pray for you because you have a complex. It's really saying you don't like anybody. In order to have friends, you must show yourself friendly. If you got something out of this small lesson today, make some noise. This could be life-changing for somebody because I believe God wants us to be friends, real friends. And I want to be your friend. And in this church, whenever you need a friend, I think you'll be able to find one. Somebody who may not know Jesus Christ as I'd like you to know him. And there's no greater friend. He's a friend of sinners. In fact, he even says, I don't call you servants. I call you friends. Because the servant doesn't get shared with this kind of information, but a friend. One person wrote a song that I love so much. It's, oh, what a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege it is to carry. Somebody this morning has been carrying some things, but there's a privilege you can have today to give those burdens to the Lord. You don't have any problems. All you need is faith. So we're going to give you an opportunity. We're going to pray a simple prayer. You can walk out of this church today connected with the greatest friend you'll ever have in your life, and that's Jesus Christ. All heads bowed, if you would, and eyes closed. And we're going to ask you today, if you're just that person that's not ashamed, that said, look here, I feel I don't have a friend. I don't have a rapport with Jesus Christ. I've got a lot of friends in college and high school, but I have never developed a rapport with Jesus Christ. I want him in my life today. Raise your hand wherever you are. If that's you, this is, I want Jesus in my life today. I want a rapport with him. If I don't have any other friends, I see a hand over there. If I don't have any other friends, I want Jesus as one of my friends. What a friend we have in Jesus. Are you here today? Amen. I want you to have Jesus as your friend, even if you don't care for me. I want to be your friend, but I'd rather you have Jesus, because there's many things I'd love to happen in your life that I can't make happen. Any other hands, I'd just like to be raised. We have a gift we'd like to give you and an assigned material. Just say, I don't think I know Jesus. I think if I were to die tonight, I don't know if I would go to heaven. I don't know where I would go because I've never developed a rapport, a real friendship with Jesus. If you're that person, nobody's going to point you out. Just raise your hand wherever you are. I thank God for the hands that's been raised. And we're going to pray a simple prayer that's going to change that. After this prayer, you can say, I'm a friend of God, and he's a friend of mine. Heads about, very simple. Just say, Lord Jesus, I repent of my sins. I receive you as my Lord and my Savior. Come into my heart. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. I will serve you from this day forward. In Jesus' name, amen. Wow, it's over already? Yes, it is. Thank you so much for watching today. I know this word has made a difference and will make a difference. Remember now, destiny is not a destination, but a journey. Stick with us. Let's journey together. Your life is going to be better.
You can join us on the same station at the same time, or better yet, come to 9615 Dyer and worship in person. I believe that participation is much more fun and fulfilling than spectating. We'd love to have you. You're welcome to come as you are. No need to dress up or dress down. Just come as you are. God is ready to meet you with us at Destiny to help lead us to a rich and a satisfying life through a growing relationship with Jesus Christ.
Remember, we're better together. May God bless you.